In this lecture, we will understand how virtual memory and paging works in XV6. Please refer to this URL for information about the complete series of lectures. So let us understand how the virtual address space of a process looks in XV6. So XV6, the version of code that we are reading, is a 32-bit operating system. So you have 2 to the 32, that is 4 gigabytes of virtual address space for every process, right? So we've seen this concept of a virtual address space before in the earlier lectures. So the virtual address space of a process is divided into pages, multiple pages, say 4 KB pages. And each of these pages, each of these valid logical pages is mapped to a physical frame by the operating system, right? So the address space, which has a bunch of pages, each of these pages is mapped to a physical frame by the operating system. And every process has a data structure called the page table that keeps track of this mappings from virtual addresses to physical addresses. Every process has a page table. And there is one page table entry for every page. Right? If you have n pages, you will have n page table entries in the page table of the process. And each page table entry contains the physical frame number to which that particular logical page is mapped by the operating system. Okay, so this is the basic concept of paging that we've seen in previous lectures. Now, getting into more details about how this page table is organized in XV6, as we've seen, your virtual address space is 2 to the 32 bytes, your page size is 2 to the 12 bytes, which is 4 KB. Therefore, you can have up to 2 to the 20 pages per process. And therefore, you will have 2 to the 20 page table entries, right? So a page table is nothing but, you can think of it as logically an array with these 2 to the 20 page table entries, right? So there are 2 to the 20 page table entries in a page table. You can think of it like they're arranged in an array, okay? So you look at your virtual address, your 32-bit virtual address, look at the top 20 bits that will give you the page number, and use these 20 bits to index into the page table to find the suitable page table entry corresponding to that particular page, right? Look at the page number, index into the page table using the page number to locate the page table entry of a particular page, okay? So if you look inside this page table entry, what will it have? This page table entry will have a physical frame number and it will have some flags, right? In essence, a page table entry is simply a pointer to the actual physical frame that has the contents of that page. So if you look inside the page table entry, what will you find? You'll find a physical frame number and you're going to find some flags. Okay, we'll come to what these flags are in a little bit. So how do you translate an address? You are given this virtual address, which is a 20-bit page number along with a 12-bit offset. So you index into the page table, locate the page table entry, find the physical frame number, and then this physical frame number plus the 12-bit offset, if you add, that will give you the physical address that you need corresponding to this virtual address. Okay. So now what are these flags? There are many flags. The important ones are indicated here. There is one flag indicating if a page is present or not. Note that every process need not use all the 2 to the 20 pages, right? It may not have that much memory to store. So this flag indicates if a page table entry, if the page corresponding to that page table entry is present or not. If it is not present and the program tries to access it, it will cause a page fault. Another flag indicates if the page is writable or not. If it is not writable, you can only read, and if a process tries to write to it, once again, it will trap into the operating system. And another flag indicates if it's a user page or not. If this flag is set, then it is a user page. And if it is not a user page, then only the kernel can access that page, right? So in all the pages of a process, for all the valid pages, all of these permission bits, everything are set. And we've already seen how address translation happens. You look at the virtual address, get the page number, map it to the physical frame number, add the offset, that will give you the physical address. And this address translation is what is done by the memory management unit. Now, the actual page table is actually not a logical array, a big array like that, right? All these 2 to the 20 page table entries cannot be stored contiguously. Therefore, your page table will have 2 levels. In XV6, it is a 2-level page table because it's a 32-bit operating system. In 64-bit operating systems, you can have many more levels in the page table. So what are these 2 levels? You first have 2 to the 10 inner page table pages, okay, each of which stores 2 to the 10 page table entries each, right? So you have a bunch of inner page tables which store the page table entries, that is, which actually point to the physical frame numbers. Okay, so you have 2 to the 10 such inner page table pages, each with 2 to the 10 page table entries, so that all of these total 2 to the 20 page table entries can be accommodated. And then you have an outer page directory, which in turn stores pointers to all of these inner page table, right? It also stores PT-like references to these inner page tables. So this is called the outer page directory. Okay. And the address of this page directory, it is what is stored in the CR3 register of your CPU. And this is what is used by the MMU during address translation. So how does the MMU translate an address? It will start with a 32-bit virtual address. It will extract the first 10 bits of that virtual address that will be used to index into the page directory. Then the next 10 bits will be used to index into the inner page table. And from that, you will get the physical frame number. You will add that to the offset, and that will give you the final physical address. So this translation is done by the MMU using these page tables, which are set up by the operating system. Right, so XV6 code defines a lot of macros like this that will help you extract the various indices into the page directory and the inner page tables. So now that we've understood how a page table works, let us look at how the virtual address space of a process is set up in XV6. So the memory image of a process, the address space of a process starting at 0, has the following things. Right. So starting at 0, you have this address space that has a bunch of things. At the beginning, you have the code data from the executable. And then in XV6, you have a fixed size stack. The stack is not variable sized like in real operating systems. You have a fixed size stack. And the stack also has a guard page so that it doesn't overflow into other pages that have useful information. And then finally, you have a heap. So this heap, initially it's not allocated, but as and when memory is required, this heap can expand to whatever size. So this is how the user part of the memory is organized in the virtual address space of a process. Now, in addition to all this code data, stack, and heap, the virtual address space of a process beginning at address 2GB also has the kernel code and data mapped into it, right? So if you look into the page table of the process, into the virtual address space of a process, you will have the OS code and data also mapped into the virtual address space of a process, starting from this variable defined as kernbase, which is equal to 2GB, right? So high virtual addresses in a process, they will map to actual OS code and data stored in RAM. Okay, so the page table of a process basically has two sets of page table entries. One set of page table entries have mapping to the user code, data, stack, heap, and so on. And the other set of page table entries contain mapping to the kernel code and other data structures of the kernel, right? So these kernel entries will map high virtual addresses and the user entries will map low virtual addresses. And note that a process can only access the memory that is mapped by its page table. A process can only access this virtual address space that it sees. It can access its own code and data, and it can access some OS code and data, but it cannot go and access the memory of other processes and so on, right? So the page table, whatever is mapped in the page table, only that a process can access. And you have different page tables for different processes, and the page table has to be switched. For example, when you do a context switch, you will have to update the page table of a process, right? So this is the virtual address space of a process in XV6. We'll understand this in a little bit more detail in the coming slides, right? So first thing is, why is the OS mapped into the address space of every process? What is this that's happening, right? Let us understand that in some detail. So the OS code and data structures is part of the virtual address space of every process, okay? So what does that mean? Here you have your process. Here you have the virtual address space of a process. So beginning from 2GB to 2GB plus 5-stop, right? Whatever variable is called 5-stop is defined in XV6. This virtual addresses map to the actual OS code and data structures and everything located in RAM at addresses 0 to 5-stop. Okay, so at boot up, the OS code and data and everything is copied into RAM and starting from address 0. So it's not exactly starting at 0, but let's assume for now somewhere starting close to 0. So the OS code and data resides here, and these physical addresses are added to the page table at virtual addresses starting at 2GB. Right, so the page table entries will map 2GB to 2GB plus 5-stop, this range of virtual addresses to 0 to 5-stop, these physical addresses. Okay, note that there is only one copy of the OS code in memory, and another process also, its high virtual addresses also will map to the same physical addresses. Right, so this is process P1, this is process P2. Both of them, their page tables will map to the same physical memory that has the OS code and data, right? You don't have multiple copies of the operating system, but the same physical memory is mapped into the address space, into the page table of every process in XV6. And these kernel mappings are, of course, identical. These page table entries are identical across all processes. Okay, so the question comes up, why are you doing this? Why are you adding the OS code into the page table of every process? If you know where the OS code is located in memory, can't you just directly access it? Why add it to the page table? You need to add it to the page table because once MMU is turned on, once paging is turned on, physical memory can only be accessed by assigning a virtual address to it, by mapping it into some page table. Okay, so if you want to access a certain OS code or data structure, you have to assign a virtual address to it, and you have to use this virtual address to access that physical memory, right? You cannot directly jump to this physical memory. Therefore, in order to access the OS code, you will map it to some virtual address and then use this virtual address to access the OS code and data. Okay, so the convenience of having the OS code and data mapped into the same page table as that of the process is that when a trap occurs, you can simply easily jump to the OS code and data. The same page table has all the mapping, so you don't have to switch a page table or anything. The same page table can be used to access all the kernel code and data during a trap. Okay, so if the OS were not part of the virtual address space, then you would have to use a different page table or something like that, right? So having the OS mapped into your page table of every process lets a process easily access the OS code and data during a trap. So a little bit more about the OS page table mappings. So as we have seen, let us draw that figure again. Starting at 2GB to 2GB plus 5-stop, these virtual addresses in every process are mapped to these physical addresses, 0 to 5-stop. Okay. And this portion, 0 to 5 stop, has the kernel code data, some memory reserved for IO devices, and it has a lot of free pages, right? So the OS will not occupy all of it. Most of it is free pages. And these free pages, so some part of it is taken up by the OS and some part of it is free pages, okay? Now, within these free pages, what happens to these free pages? These free pages are assigned to user processes. Whenever a user process wants memory to store its code, data, stack, heap, whatever, these free pages are assigned. Okay, so let us understand how this free pages are managed. So suppose there is a physical frame at address P. Okay, so this physical frame, this physical memory can be accessed by virtual address V by the kernel. Okay, where this V is nothing but P plus 2GB, right? Everything is just offset by kern base 2GB here. So a certain physical memory location P can be accessed by the kernel at a virtual address V. Now, this free page can now, this piece of memory can now be assigned to a user process. And the user process, when it asks for memory, the kernel will return a pointer to this physical memory frame. And the user process will map this physical memory frame at address U. Right? It cannot use the same address V to access that physical memory frame. Why? Because this high virtual addresses are kernel virtual addresses. These page table mappings are not accessible to a user process. Therefore, the user process will use another virtual address in the range 0 to 2GB. Say, let's call that address U to access the same physical frame P. Right? So what do you have in the page table? You have the page table maps address U to P. It also maps address V to P, right? Both these mappings are present in the page table of the process. The same frame P is mapped twice into the page table at different virtual addresses, okay? And when the user process is accessing this memory, suppose the user process has stored its code here and it's accessing this code to run it, then it will use these virtual addresses starting at U to access that memory. When the kernel wants to access that page, suppose it wants to zero out that page or store the code in that page from the disk, whatever, when the kernel is accessing that page, it will use the high virtual address V. Okay. So in this way, most of the RAM is accessible to the kernel at high virtual addresses, and it's also accessible, the free pages are accessible to user processes at low virtual addresses. One, what is the result of this? Every byte of RAM actually consumes 2 bytes in the virtual address space. 1 byte of RAM eats up 2 bytes in the virtual address space. So therefore, because you have 32-bit virtual address space, XV6 can only access up to 2GB of RAM, right? This 2GB of RAM has eaten up 4GB of virtual address space. And therefore, if your system that is running XV6 has more than 2GB of RAM, XV6 will not be able to use it because there is not enough virtual addresses to assign to all that memory. And if you don't assign virtual addresses, if something is not mapped in your page table, you cannot access it. So then what about real operating systems? So real operating systems deal with it much better, right? So for example, when a free page is assigned to a user process, the kernel's page table entry can be deleted. There's no reason for both of them to keep a pointer to it. Either the user is using the page or the kernel is using the page, right? So some such optimizations are done by real operating systems because obviously modern systems use more than 2GB of RAM. But this is a limitation of XV6, which is why XV6 cannot use more than 2GB of RAM. Okay, so now we've seen that after boot up, the RAM contains OS code and data, and a lot of the RAM is free. It just contains free pages. And these free pages we've just seen are allotted to user processes, right? They are mapped into the user part of the virtual address space at different virtual addresses. So how does the OS maintain all of these free pages? It maintains them in some sort of a linked list-like structure called the free list. Okay, so it is defined here. There is a free list. This is nothing but a pointer to a structure called run, okay? So the way it is organized is these are all the free pages, and the pointers across this linked list are stored within the page itself. So the page is empty, it has nothing inside it. Therefore, the address of the next free page is stored in the previous free page. The address of the next page is stored in the previous page. In this way, within the page itself, you will write a small structure, this run structure, which is nothing. It just has a pointer to the next page. It just has a pointer to the next run structure, which has a pointer to the next run structure, and so on, right? That is all a free page has. And the kernel will simply maintain a pointer to this kmm.freelist, simply maintains a pointer to the first free page. And from then on, you follow these pointers to get the entire free list, right? It is a linked list. And the pointer to the first page is maintained by the kernel. Okay. And whenever a process wants free pages, it is assigned from this list. And whenever a process frees up memory, it is sent back to this list. So these functions, klock and kfree by the kernel, are responsible for allocating and freeing memory from these from this list of free pages. So what does klock do? So you have your free list pointer. This kmm.freelist is pointing to some free page, which is pointing to the next free page, and so on. So what do? You first take a pointer to this first free page, and then you shift this kmm to the next pointer. Now kmm will go to the next variable of r, right? So your kmm has been updated, and this value of r is what you will return. When somebody asks for a free page, you will return the first page in this list, and kmm.freelist will point to the next page. Similarly, when somebody frees up memory also, it is similar. So your kmm is dot freelist is pointing to some page, some free page, and then a new page has come in. You put the run structure, right? The run structure into that new page, and this page r. Then you set its next pointer to kmm.freelist, and then you update kmm.freelist to point to r, right? In this way, a freed up page is added to the head of the free list, and the free list pointer is updated, right? So the kernel has a list of free pages, and user processes or any other system call or any other piece of code can allocate and free up these free pages. So this is the summary of what we've studied in this lecture. We've studied how virtual address spaces are built in XV6. There's a 4GB virtual address space for each process. Note that XV6 does not have demand paging. Whatever virtual address space is created, it is assigned a physical frame. And we've seen that there is a two-tier page table. There's an outer page directory and a bunch of inner page tables. And the process address space has user memory mapped at low virtual addresses, and the kernel code and data is mapped at high virtual addresses beyond 2GB. And in this part of the kernel code and data that is mapped at high virtual addresses, there is the operating system image itself and its data structures and some small amount of memory for IO devices. And most of it is free pages, which are available to be assigned to user processes. So I have omitted in this discussion how this free page list is constructed during boot up and how the available RAM is added into this free page list by the operating system. So I've omitted those details for the sake of simplicity, but please go back and refer to the XV6 code in the XV6 book to understand them in more detail. So in the next lecture, we are going to see how memory is allocated to user processes in various system calls from this list of free pages and how the page tables are built for user processes.